everyone. Happy to have you here for another episode of Legacy Matters. Our show is growing, and the lives and legacies of the people around us have taken on a new importance as we take stock of what is most precious to us. As always, our show will focus on building and preserving your legacy, the importance of community, and the telling of stories we find amusing. Thanks for joining us. Now, enjoy the show. Let's do it.
We're here.
We're
back.
Yep. Legacy
All
Matters.
Of us. All three of us.
We are in the very well lit, very...
I would say atmospherically lit.
Ooh, atmospherically.
It's lovely.
It's very different today.
I love what
today.
You've done with the lighting.
I had no idea it was like this when I got here, but it looks great. Mm,
yeah. And since we don't know where any of the
light switches are,
light switches are anything.
There's very little we can do
Somebody
about
did
it.
A really good job.
Yeah, it's great. Well, anyway, the Comedy Corner Underground, thanks for the space. Yeah,
always.
Comedy Corner Underground is in the Corner Bar.
Yes.
Here in Sunny Seven Corners, Minneapolis.
Minneapolis, Minnesota.
That's right.
Yeah, Minnesota, USA, North America.
I think
we'll
that's
go the
it.
Whole thing.
We got it.
Planet
of
Earth.
The world.
Planet Earth. Yep.
Yep.
Woo. Good. Covered. Now
that way,
know.
If you're going to Google the whole thing, you can. You right. got every single.
Well, we don't know where this is being transmitted. I mean, now we're covered.
Shout out to Idaho.
Yep.
Or aliens.
yeah, exactly. That's where I was headed.
Right.
Zorbot,
probably.
Yeah. We aren't sponsored by aliens, but if you aliens out there would care to sponsor us, we are in the
and
market.
We would love
for
to have you on the show. Yeah.
You know how to get a hold of us.
Yep.
Yeah.
I'm sure you've been watching.
That would be kind of kick-ass to be the first podcast.
Or the lizard people that live in the core of the planet. Aliens or lizard people, all
yeah.
are welcome.
Are we broadcasting down?
I don't know how that works.
Okay.
It's radio waves. Fact it's check. A little tough for me to
we'll
understand.
Fact check it.
Yeah. I mean, I doubt it. Well, and we don't actually do it on the radio. We actually
exactly, I know. Exactly.
So if they have...
It's so old.
If their Wi-Fi sucks out there...
Yeah, if they can pick up the RSS happening. Feed, they got us. It's
go.
Good.
It comes right. in after Jupiter, so they're good. Yeah.
Nice.
Anyway, what are we doing but wasting time? We have a guest,
Never
and
always.
He's already yep. warned us that he's got no time constraints.
Well, that's why we're rambling.
And I have
now he's like, I should have said maybe there is an end time.
Yeah, I did. I did happen to meet our guest at one point not too long ago, and. My understanding, I'll get to that story or I won't. Maybe I'll just tell it now,
we never
whatever.
Know.
But
we could introduce him.
He walked for something like 24 hours, and I bet he never stopped talking the whole time. So this could be a marathon of a podcast.
I like it.
Hi, guest. Hi, Joshua Hoyt.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Yeah.
Welcome.
Thanks.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining. So you're
walked
Joshua
Hoyt. Walked
for
24 hours straight?
He did.
24 hours straight this year. We did 12 hours last year.
Oh, okay.
Yep.
I didn't.
That's 36
didn't
in total.
To yeah. Don't
just in
try
case.
And trick me with math. Not okay.
Over the course of 2 years. Huh?
Right.
Yeah. But I mean, we should just launch right into that.
Yeah.
Because
please.
Why wouldn't we?
Why
right.
wouldn't we?
I
right?
did.
That felt very leading.
Yeah. Yeah. What were you doing walking?
So it is the American Cancer Society's Relay for Life.
Okay.
And... I forgive my facts, but years ago it was started by a gentleman who walked for 24 hours to raise awareness for cancer
right.
and ultimately cancer research and funding and fundraising. So coming into 2019, that would have been the first year of COVID. The traditional Relay for Life events kind of disappeared
oh,
because
yeah.
the whole social distancing
yeah.
thing.
Sure.
Right.
And so the first event that I attended was 2021 because they didn't have one in 20. And it was just a very small local event. They had the Luminaria Walk where they put the bags out. And, you know, again, it's for survivors, caretakers, mm-hmm. and overall raising awareness and money for the American Cancer Society. Well, I looked at it and I was deeply affected by cancer. And I said, no, fuck this. We
yeah.
got to do something much bigger. We got to
yeah.
get it back. And so I've got some pretty good connections. And I happen to be better than average at community outreach and mm-hmm.
Oh, I thought you were going to say walking.
So,
yeah.
Oh, no, we got the walking down.
Yeah, yeah. Been working on that for a while.
So I just said, here, we're gonna put this thing on steroids and get it back and give it the attention that it deserves. So
cool.
Last year, I walked by myself for 12 hours. I ended up, what did I do for mileage? It was like, God, I don't even remember. It was like 20 miles or something.
Right.
No, I'm sorry. It was 31 and a half miles last year. It was 31 and a half last year in 12 hours. and we raised $60,000 or so.
Wow.
So this year I'm like, we got to do it even bigger.
Yeah.
So I said, I'm going to walk for 24 hours, only taking the, you know, the piss breaks, changing right. shoes, socks, whatever it is. And this year's event raised just short of $92,000.
That's great.
But I also had one of our council members and our police chief walk with me, and we did 24 hours. We did just over 50 miles.
Ah. Yeah. Wow.
So cool. It was...
Now I got to ask, you said you walk like a circle or
round
a
track. Specific
round a track. Yeah. Okay, that's what it's like, just let me meandering tell you, around.
Yeah. The things you learn lot, yeah. walking around a track for yeah. even 12 hours.
Yeah. I bet.
Yeah.
Like right. you have to rotate directions every mile yeah. or every hour.
Sure.
You say you have to. Why is that?
Because there's a slight pitch to the track. Okay. Like there's that, you know, yeah. 0.0173 right. repeating degree yeah. difference
some
in
people
the track.
Are moving and can use that.
And after a few hours, yeah. your one hip is just on fire. So yeah. you have to sure. do it so that you balance them out.
Right.
And, you know, things you would never have thought about.
But I thought you were going to say
that
probably yeah. repetitive. Yeah. yeah.
Not
yeah.
till about hour three, you're like, wait, something's not right here.
Well, you've seen that yeah. Simpson episode where, yeah. you know, Maggie's doing the
yeah.
this thing to Bart's arm. He's yeah. like, I'll quit it.
Yeah.
Do that for 24 hours and you'll be bruised. So
I'll quit it.
Right. Yeah. 24 hours of walking is it'll get to you.
How absolutely. Many pairs of shoes do you have on the side of the track for something like that?
So you have two pairs.
Okay.
That way, if for some reason you have a problem with one or they get wet.
Okay.
But you go through about half a dozen pairs of socks. Mm. And wow. then moleskin is your friend.
Mm. Sure.
You know, like in marathoners will tell you all the stories. Right. But, you know, you just...
Did you Band-Aid the... No? No Band-Aids in it?
On the nipples?
I did, I did last year.
Yeah, okay.
I did last year because we walked from 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. and it was hot. It was like 90 degrees. Yeah. And so you get chafing.
Yep.
This year was 6 p.m. to 6 p.m. and it was a lot cooler, so we nice. Didn't have to, but...
No chafing.
Yes, absolutely. Yeah. And huge thanks to Sam for coming out and walking with us. And
yeah.
You put in some time. You were out there for a few hours.
Yeah, I was out there, I think 3 hours
yeah.
or so.
Yeah.
You know, my father's dealing with his cancer. My mother had cancer. I just lost a friend from the military. I just figured, like, I needed to walk.
Yeah,
you know, I right. needed to see right. people and walk, and it worked well. But
yeah, it was great.
Yeah,
it was good
congratulations
to see
doing
thank
that.
Thank you.
Yeah, very cool.
It's great.
Yeah, you raised a lot of good money. Yeah, congratulations.
Thank you. We got good coverage, so we, you know, Fox 9 and Courtney Godfrey was out there doing the pre-walk interview. And
nice.
It was awesome to see it grow year over year, and next year it'll be even bigger.
So you were able to talk for 3 hours?
You know, it's not exactly hard for me, generally speaking.
What?
You know, I did some listening, too. I was in a is that the right word?
Let's go with
contemplative.
Yes. Contemplative. Yes. I think you can say it. Well, anyway,
you can say it either.
Yeah, whatever. I like contemplative. It sounds very fancy.
It's
almost French.
It's bougie.
It's super bougie. I listened, but I talked too. Yeah.
And when you talk, you walk faster.
Yeah.
You sure. learn that as well.
Because you just keep going.
You get in a conversation. Yeah. Next thing you know, you look down, you're doing, you know, 3 mile an hour pace. And you're like, whoa.
Yeah,
like,
slow it down. Not slow it down.
Easy turbo. Yeah.
Yeah, right.
It's not a sprint.
Yeah.
No. No. I mean, some people do run for 24 hours. Those people are crazy, too.
The ultramarathoners?
Okay. Yeah.
They're batshit crazy.
Yeah. I mean.
There's something wrong there.
I don't know what to say about them other than that's just frick-fracking weird.
Yeah.
Like, running for the... Anyway.
Yeah.
We all agree. I thought there would be someone say, no, that's normal, but...
I look like a runner of the group, but...
Yeah.
Yeah, no.
You could have waited. I have a friend in common
who is an
ultra runner.
An old, good old friend.
Yeah. And like 100 milers and shit like that.
Yeah.
That's
and
his weirdness.
He's just the perfect amount of crazy, though.
Yeah.
He is. He's always been a little bit like if there's a peak of craziness, he hasn't fallen off the cliff.
Right on the edge.
He's right on the edge. Yeah.
Comfortable. Nice.
Yeah. Made him a hell of a good guitarist.
Yeah.
Hey, Pete Tripp.
Yeah, shout out Pete Tripp.
Yep, what? Shout out. That's Dan Waldschmidt, who is the reason. Yeah. Dan,
no way, Dan, this goes back to Dan.
Yes, this goes back
come
to Dan.
On.
Dan is the first person to do the million shout outs on the show.
I love that.
First and only.
Yeah.
Really.
Dan has great people.
I think we count 145 shout-outs.
Something like that.
And that was just one episode.
Then I got an email from him, said, hey, can you mention my two other friends who I forgot to shout out to? And I'm like, I don't know if I ever mentioned them, but shout out to those two friends from Dan. Yeah. He'll listen to this and he'll be
tell them. That was for you.
Yeah.
You don't need to say the names. They'll know they're them.
Dan will clear it up.
So Dan's from your neck of the woods, right?
So I went to school with him and his sisters.
Okay.
So know the Waldschmidt family well.
Okay. Yep. And if you haven't listened to it,
Minnesota's a small area because we all know each other, but it's really not.
I mean, it's a fairly big state.
It's pretty big.
Way bigger
10,000 lakes, 5.2 million people.
A bunch of people. How do we all know each other?
It's 13,000.
It's 13,562 or whatever. But
who's top looking stuff up? Right.
Now, we don't do facts on the show, by the way.
Yeah, I like that. You cannot start now.
We present information as if it's fact.
Right.
Knowing full well it probably is.
I mean, if I'm being honest, it's easier for the listener to Google it while we're talking about it than it would be for us to look it up.
Well, I mean, how boring would a show be where you're just looking things up the whole time?
I can't expect it to
someone's
going to
do a Google everything show.
You're assuming they're fully tuned in, listening to every word.
Right. Writing it down vigorously.
So where is your and Dan's neck of the woods for our listeners?
Farmington is the southeasternmost city of Dakota County, which is the southeastern county of the metropolitan area.
Uh-huh.
Yep. So if you know where Lakeville's at, we're due east.
Yeah.
You know, 30 minutes or so.
It didn't take me very long to get down there.
No.
It was right there.
Yeah.
Is there is there a special position you maybe hold within the community?
That sounds loaded.
I'm here leading.
I may or may
leading
not.
The
leading the witness. Totally leading the witness.
Objection!
Yeah, exactly.
No, I was
you're
elected.
Good at that.
5 years ago now, 2018, I was elected as a city council member.
Mm-hmm.
And then 2 years ago, so in 20, I was elected as the mayor for the city of Farmington.
What? Wow.
And we don't do facts, but I have to do this drop all the time.
Right.
See, it's good that you don't know that because you didn't ask questions, right?
Yeah.
You violate your own rule.
Yeah.
Right.
So I won't throw the fact of the fact, but so when I ran in 2018 as a write-in, we know what a write-in is.
Oh, yeah. Okay?
Oh, yeah.
So I had 7 ballot candidates. I finished number 2, but winning as a write-in, my campaign came out of the highest population city in Minnesota state history.
Yeah.
So no one in Minnesota has ever done it from a larger city.
Right.
And I did it against 7 ballot candidates.
Nice.
Are you somewhat
7
competitive?
Candidates.
Somewhat?
Yeah, somewhat.
Is this
highly?
I only walk 12 hours? Screw that. Yeah. I'm doubling it next year.
Is this something that you would label yourself as maybe would be competitive?
Yes, very much so.
Yeah, that's good.
Highly competitive.
Highly competitive. So you...
There are no losers. They're just not winners.
They're just not winners. I didn't really want to be mayor. I just wanted to win it to prove I could.
Yeah. Does it stick in your craw a little bit that you didn't get the most votes, that you were number 2? Because I heard a little pain when you said...
So technically... Okay,
I won't go too far into this.
The city of Farmington, because we have a shared post office, the adjoining townships all have Farmington addresses.
Sure.
Wait a minute. Are there like private club post offices somewhere that what do you mean shared post office?
So most cities, so your address, the city that's on there is not necessarily the city that you live in. It is the city where your post office is located. That's why you have...
These are things a mayor would know and no one else.
No, these are things that like the average American should know.
It's called a zip code, and you've got one too.
So there are locations where you'll get mail and you'll be like, why do I have 2 names on my address, but I live in this city? It's because your post office is shared between 2 municipalities.
Okay.
So like all of our local townships, you don't have like Empire Township or Eureka Township on your address. It says Farmington.
Mm-hmm.
Our school district encompasses a lot of those townships. There happened to be a significant number of write-ins for our school district ballot at the same time. So I'm not saying, but I think that the uptick in write-ins, which they look and they go, oh, it's not you, right? Because I'm running for council.
Right.
Had you factored in a majority of those, I would have won by a landslide.
Right.
Just
but I'm just saying.
conjecture, but probably right.
Yeah. I like it. I like
close
it.
Close enough so, to truth for this.
No facts in there.
Yeah. No. It's all in
it works
good
better
fun.
That way.
So you have some administrative, like, things that stuff you do then for the city, yeah.
Well,
right?
He's a yeah. mayor. So.
Yeah, I know. Yeah. I mean, we've had...
Well, you said you won, still currently.
Correct. Yeah. So okay. I won in 18. Right. I won...
By write-in.
By write-in.
Yeah, right. And then you got yourself on the ballot the next time.
Correct.
For mayor.
So it's a four-year term.
Okay.
And when our last mayor retired and left at the end of his term, his seat became vacant. I ran against two of my peers who I was sitting on council with. I beat both of them combined.
Well, yeah, do you rub it in ever?
Yeah.
You...
Only when I'm asked.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. He just drives by their house and
I'm competitive, but I'm not vindictive or like,
you know, there is a line.
There's a line.
Fair enough.
So then I start a new 4-year term. So I'm in my fifth year of elected or being elected, but I'm in my third year as mayor. So I'm up next fall for election.
Okay. Yep. So a year from now. And you'll run again? You going to keep doing this for a while?
99.9% I'll run.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The work's not done.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, do you feel like you can exact some change there? Like, do you feel like you can get things done in Farmington? That
we have made some very significant changes the last few years, but our city is in a very transformative time. We're transitioning from the rural. Mm-hmm. They call them like nesting communities, you know, because most of our, and I'm trying not to statistic drop because that's how my brain works, but there's a large percentage of our residents that leave Farmington for work.
Yep.
Yeah.
And so we have made a lot of changes. We've made a lot of progress, but I'm not one to leave things undone. And so I believe through the remainder of this term, along with, as long as the voters choose me for the next term, we will make sure that most of those items get knocked off the list, and from there the team can take it.
Good.
So, yeah.
So this is, I'm guessing, because Farmington is a growing community, this is a more than full-time job, or is mayor a part-time gig in a town size of Farmington?
So
naivety, it's okay. because I know the least about politics of anyone here. Probably.
Oh, that's true.
So, yeah.
I get this often, right?
Okay.
And people go, well, what do you, you know, they assume it's a full-time job because they see people like, you know, Melvin Carter or Jacob Fry.
Like you have an office where it says
correct.
Mayor right. Joshua.
You have staff, you have an assistant. Yeah. I don't even have an office.
Okay.
So, like, we have a big city hall, but I don't have an office.
Sure.
But
they don't give the mayor an office? Come on, Farmington.
Some cities do, but the more you get to know me, the more you'll know that, like, here, we're podcasting in the basement of a comedy club, and we're makeshifting, and we're going to put out good content.
Yeah.
You do your work wherever your work needs to be done.
Right.
The office, to me, is more, like, positional. Like, that's what I would expect to see out of an elected official or mayor.
Well,
but
it's where
it's
you
not me.
Store paperwork.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
we're digital. Yeah. Yeah. Sam, 2023. Right. We're digital.
They
right?
do have Wi-Fi down in Farmington.
To answer your question, when I first got involved, I had talked to some people who had previously been elected, and I had this picture drawn that it was like, you know, a couple hours a week, a couple of meetings, a lot of community outreach, a lot of volunteer work. And when I got in, I realized, well, there's a lot more that needs to be done.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So there are no requirements other than attending a couple of meetings and your commissions and boards that you are appointed to. Outside of that, it's what you make it.
Right.
Okay.
What you want to do with it.
What you want to do with
like
it.
Kind of like that.
So yeah. I am big in setting the standard. I mean, I want people to see that it's not talk, it's action, and that's how I was so successful in my mayoral campaign, because I didn't have to tell you about it. You had seen it for 2 years.
Sure.
And when I first got elected to mayor, that first quarter, January, February, March, I mean, I probably spent 30 or 40 hours a week. I was not operating my own business at the time, because there's a huge learning curve. There's a lot. You got to come up to speed with a lot of things. Now I probably spend, I would say, anywhere from 3 to 6 hours a week. Mm-hmm. But there are some weeks that it's 10, 15 hours.
Right. Yeah. Mayoring.
Right. Mayoring.
Yeah. Right.
Do you have, do you do like attorneys do, where you have like a thing on your phone and you're like, boop, on the clock, mayoring?
No.
He's got to track his clock. Time.
No,
you don't.
No. No. Yeah, it is a $7,000 a year paid position.
Yeah. You don't want to look at how much time you're doing
that. No, that sounds like 3 hours a week.
Seven grand.
This is,
that's great, though.
So not to go down the political rabbit hole, but you hear a lot about why the political system is so charged and why there are not good people getting involved with
are
it.
Are you fixing that?
Well, I'm trying to do it through self... by putting myself immersive into this.
Yeah.
The reason,
leading by example.
Leading by example.
Yeah.
One of the main reasons I believe that, just based on my experience, that you don't get a lot of younger people and as much time commitment is it doesn't pay.
Right.
Mm-hmm. There is a moral part of you to do the work, but you typically see a lot of retired, self-employed, empty nesters. You see people that have the ability to spend the time to do the work.
Right.
Ask a 20 or 30 something to commit 10 hours a week to something for a few hundred dollars.
It's impossible.
Not happening.
Yeah, very much so.
You know, it's also the work of doing what politicians do. So we're kind of, I wouldn't say we're apolitical on this show. That's not exactly accurate. Mm. But we don't, I we're all very tired of this divided politics bullshit.
Yeah.
Like it's really not healthy.
No.
But, you know, I used to attend my local caucuses and stuff. It's also boring as fuck.
Yeah.
Sorry. It is. That's part of the problem. So getting young people, like, they got to jazz it up just a little bit and pay them and get the young
maybe
people.
Maybe a DJ, some background music, something to kind of set the mood.
Disco, like a ball.
Now you're going back. Disco ball, now you're aging. I don't think kids would be excited about a disco ball.
Joshua, show up to City Hall,
there's a disco ball. He's like, no, that's not bringing the kids in.
No, so do you pal around with other, like, mayors from the region or other people? Like, do you have, like, old mayor's club where you smoke cigars and
show where you're going with that?
There is quite a few things that you do as an elected official around other elected officials. So we have our semi-monthly, or I should say bi-monthly, mayor-manager meetings. So it's all of the cities within Dakota County and the city administrators, the city managers meet together, talk about emerging topics, what's working in other communities, and we travel amongst different municipalities. You also work in smaller groups, so it's volunteer. There is a group of seven of us that we meet Friday mornings, and we simply work on ourselves, because as mayors, when you get to the, you know, I'll say the top of the food chain, and you don't have someone outside your residence to report to, you also don't have a system to vent, let things go, talk about similar issues, and so we get together and just chat.
Work it out.
But there's a lot of other, you know, a lot of boards that you serve on. There's a lot of networking that you do with other elected officials at the state and national level.
I used to think networking was just like a really shitty word, like the most terrible thing possible you could do, because they kept pounding that into us in high school and college.
Connecting is what we call it, that's a better term.
Yep. No, it's fine. What I've realized is that networking for the sake of networking makes you fake. Actually connecting with people and getting that, actually the networking part of that gets stuff done.
Yeah.
Like it actually does serve a purpose.
Well illustrated.
Yeah. I used my hands, folks.
I know exactly. That's why we said illustrated.
That's why we're on radio.
I really like those sock puppets too. Well,
there's a lot of reasons we're on radio, but that's one of them. Yeah.
I think we're a relatively good looking radio crowd, to be honest. But anyway,
no one else would know.
Yeah.
So yeah.
They don't have to know, and I get it. But you don't happen to be in the same county as Newport, Minnesota, do you?
No.
No.
Okay.
That's Washington County, baby.
Correct.
Nice. Wow. You know your counties.
It's my county.
Yeah. Newport, South St. Paul, or St. Paul Park it would be, because South St. Paul is Dakota, but St. Paul Park and even Woodbury,
yes,
I think is in there.
And I live in Lake Elmo.
Oh, sure.
Yeah. 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 You know, you all the way up to Stillwater, Bayport. Mm-hmm.
Bayport, Afton.
Yep.
What's that other little one? Anyway, yeah.
Cottage Grove.
Yeah. Marine on St. Croix.
Marine on St. Croix. Yeah. That's Washington.
Nice. That's a cute little town. Yeah. Anyway.
Very cute little town.
Yeah. Yeah. Do you, you don't cross those boundaries, right? Like, you don't go, I'm just wondering if you know Joe Hatch.
So we cross boundaries at different events, like, so we call it the LMC. It's a League of Minnesota Cities. It's the organization that oversees all the cities, and they offer legal advice, insurance, and they're kind of the we'll say they are the baseline for how cities are supposed to operate, right?
Got it.
They have an annual conference and multiple mini conferences or learning opportunities through the year where you network from people both in metro and outstate. And I've probably been to 6 or 8 of those. And you do. You get a chance to, like in June, I was meeting with the mayor of Duluth and who else? People from St. Peter and just all over, because you're always trying to figure out what are we missing? What have they learned that we can learn from? And what have we done that they can learn from? And right. So you're constantly connecting to help other communities, because that's why we're all there.
Nice.
Yeah, does the mayor of Duluth, like, do the mayors from big towns sort of strut through, like, where I'm big
I will
big
walk
town
delicately
mayor.
Here.
Yeah.
here, I'll just, because we can be very frank. There are a few very pompous elected officials,
yeah.
and Mayor Fry's one of them.
Oh, I was just kind of kidding.
Yeah, no, seriously, there are. There are some people that get into these positions, and you often hear them say, "Don't you know who I am?"
Oh,
and they,
boy.
And they have a strut. Mm. No, I get you're in a public eye, and, you know.
Yeah,
hey,
that's
great,
ridiculous.
You're
gross.
You know,
all I can think of is Anchorman. Gross. Like, I don't know how to tell you this, but I'm kind of a big deal.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't look
right.
Yeah.
Kind of a big deal. And I keep picturing all you mayors just having, like, an Anchorman-style fight in some city park.
I like it.
We're Dakota County.
Yes. Yeah, I mean, it's...
We're Hennepin.
Represent.
Yeah. But that's not even just mayors.
Right.
When it's like movie stars and stuff, right?
Right.
Dude, you did a few commercials for the company. Like, you're a big deal, right?
It would be like any one of us acting like we're famous because we got a few followers. Followers on our podcast or something.
Right.
There are some electeds that you run into that think their shit don't stink.
Yeah.
And
it's
embarrassing.
That's true of every
But then you go to their city and see the city sucks. So it's like you're not really that great. Let's be honest. What are you proud of? It ain't you.
You screwed it up.
Yeah. So what was there's usually, when someone gets involved with something new, what was the thing that pissed you off enough to go, yeah, I want to do this?
That's a good question, Mark. Ooh,
that's a great question.
I mean, because there is usually, I mean, anything that I've been involved in.
You carry it around? Like, yeah.
So this ties directly into why I ran as a write-in.
Yeah.
It was August 20th of 2018. Our police chief at the time had entered into a separation agreement with the city council. Chiefs are non-union employees. They have employment contracts. And there was an issue that was very quiet and was not being, in my opinion, handled properly. And so I went to the August 20th council meeting.
That's really politicky of you to be all like, to just skirt right around that. I'm confused. You got me confused now. Yeah.
So
good. Yeah, it's good. It's good.
Depending on who reported it and what came out, it was, what I found out after the fact was that it was bad supervision.
Yeah.
It was not clearly defined expectations from the administrator to the police chief, which turned into different expectations from the council to the police chief. And it all boiled up to this. He can't be here any longer. He needs to go. So we're going to do a separations agreement. From the public's perception, you're like, hold on.
Yeah,
why is our head cop basically being pushed out of his job?
Yeah, sure. Fair question.
So August 20th of 18, 300 of us are standing there in chambers, and I got up and I rattled off a little speech, and KSTP covered it. It had 8,000 views, and it was like all of a sudden, whoa, there's a story there.
Yeah.
Did a couple Freedom of Information requests and found out that there was some collusion between a few council members to make the guy go away. And because the filing deadline for your filing period for council had already passed, I had to run it as a write-in.
Yeah.
So
that's
how
that whole thing.
Yeah, which you were highly successful.
Right.
Highly
successful.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you endeavor to take some of the juice out of the political bullshit that people go through these days? Is that something you do, or do you have kind of your political lane, like your favorite tribe that you go with? I'm just curious.
I have no political affiliation.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I'm a purist at heart. So people ask me often, like, you know, I know it's a non-partisan position, but I believe that I'm a social liberal and I'm a fiscal conservative.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
I mean, hence we let off with the Relay for Life, right?
Yeah, yeah.
I give to others in every way possible. I believe there's programs and all the things, and that's a rabbit hole by itself. But I hate parts of the left. I hate parts of the right.
Fair
I love
enough.
Parts yeah, yeah. about the left. I love parts about the right.
Fair enough.
I hate our political system right now. It's garbage.
I don't know if you can call it a system anymore.
The system, it's like the system is money, yeah, and the money is
part
winning.
Of the system.
Yeah, yeah, it's gross.
It's not
a functional system.
Super dysfunctional.
Yeah,
oh, that's a problem. Works for those people who are making all the money off of those sweet crooked deals.
Yeah. It's functional. It is not sustainable.
It is not sustainable.
No, not at all.
We can't keep doing this. You know, sticks with me when I talk to people about this stuff is just sort of like the idea that we have to, that there's two ways of thinking of things and we have to hate the other side or something. I'm like, those are my cousins.
Do we have to hate them?
You don't have to hate me.
How are we going
to
get anything done?
You know, if you look at the polls, like, we're generally, you know, 70-80% in agreement on most things. But then there's two sides and it's like, no, we're not. We're fighting. Like, it's just dumb.
Yeah.
Dumb and unsustainable.
Do you know when it got really bad? And you can go through and you can look at polls and stuff.
I have a pretty good idea.
Social media and the internet.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. So some of it's always been there. Definitely social media has had
absolutely
an impact, without question. And I'm of the mindset that that the days of like three companies running all of what social looks like on your phone will end. There will be alternatives that put us into different spaces with different purposes.
There'll be other ways to connect versus getting your limited information that you're supposed
to. Fuck Facebook.
Here, now just read this one newspaper for the whole rest of your life. Just read one newspaper.
We were so close.
So close to getting them,
too. Sweet lucrative.
Yeah. Sorry, Mark.
Facebook money. No, I mean, the thing is, like, these things, that, especially Facebook, I'll pick on them specifically.
Why not?
When they first came out, they're going to sue me. No, they're not. They don't care. They don't care about nothing.
You don't have enough money.
No, that's right. But when they first came out, it was such a sweet little resource to stay in touch with extended family.
Yeah.
Right. Like, that's what it was good at. And then the minute it turned into something else, like, I go on there now, and I'm like, it's like information vomit
here,
or something.
You want your mind to be blown for a second?
Ooh, let's hear it. Let's hear it.
Think about this. Social media, like, there's reports that say over the last 5 years, the average person receives their news more from social media than any other source.
That's not news.
Yeah. Hold on a second, because I'm gonna go down to that lane.
Did I jump in too quick?
Okay.
Yeah.
It's like, God, I think 17 to 34 is something like 45% of people now are getting their news from social media,
the bulk information.
Right?
Yeah.
And we who don't go, no, that's not right. That's just propaganda. That's not news. But what is news? What we see in the radio station or hear in the radio station, see on TV, with going down the lane that you just commented on,
Sam, believe any of it
anymore?
Can
we believe any of that?
Because it seems like no one's doing investigative journalism anymore. It's all just about getting clicks.
I think we have to be a little bit careful about this. I do think that when we say those types of things, we lead one to believe that there is no good news being made. The problem is that the good news is being drowned out in the noise of all the shit, right? There are people out there who are absolutely good journalists.
Absolutely.
And it's like when everyone, you know, when people say, oh, all of the police are terrible. Like, nope, there's a problem in policing. We can see that. Not all the police are out to get you. Not all the police are doing bad. Not all the doctors are out to get you. They're not all doing bad. Sorry,
that's okay. Yeah. Here's where I was going with it, because you're not wrong.
Yeah.
There are truth voices out there working on platforms that are not subject to big money.
Mm-hmm. And big money is a real problem.
Real problem.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It always has been. The framers of the Constitution knew that. They, like, that when this country was founded, like, and I you know, we look back, sorry, again, I'm going on a tangent.
And that's why we don't pay politicians who are trying to keep the money out of it, right?
Right. Okay, cool. Right? Yeah. I mean, but it's always been the case that money will corrupt things. So, like, our big money-backed media sources, like, of course there's problems there. But anyway, you were saying, Joshua.
That's all right.
Sorry.
So when you look at news and you look at information that comes out, you know, there's a certain filter that we apply to say, okay, what do we believe to be true and what's not? Mm-hmm. Think about when we went through school. We would write research papers, and what did we all use as the basis for those papers?
Encyclopedia Britannica.
Library. Like, paper
the
library. Books.
The encyclopedias, right?
Multiple sources. Yeah. Books, encyclopedias.
We assume that the encyclopedias were factually
correct. tell me that encyclopedia. No, I'm just kidding.
I'm just saying, for something that went A to Z and supposedly had everything in it, I feel like there was some stuff we missed.
You mean because it was written by someone with a single agenda or viewpoint, they may have put some information in there that served their purpose?
He may have been a white male.
Maybe omitted some stuff. Maybe left some stuff out.
It's fascinating that like we did all this study and all this research and all these things, right? Based on what we thought we knew because we read it. And there was no questioning to it.
Right.
Now, the advent of technology and the internet and resources and digital archiving and all the things, we're coming to find out that, whoa, some of this stuff isn't what we thought it was. You're just seeing it at a pace.
Yes. I mean, Christopher Columbus wasn't a savior?
There may have been. No, I mean, there's
some of those books only missed part of this story.
Yeah. There's some parts of it, like it's not like there's more than one truth, right? But there are things where there's more than one side or perspective. Yes, right? But like, so there's certain things that you just have to accept collectively. We should accept as fact. This is a fact. Like Christopher Columbus sailed across in 1492 right?
He did that part.
What that meant, part. What happened after all of that stuff is up to interpretation. You leave one group to write the story. And it's going to be rah-rah this, right? And the other side, the other people are like, well, but there's a lot more to it than
but
just that.
But he sucked.
I'm not real pleased with him.
I'm not a fan. Yeah.
Turns out he was kind of a douche.
I have no idea. I never met the man, so I don't know.
Right. Well, you know? We're definitely not getting...
Christopher Columbus's
Day.
Family.
Yeah, we're good.
Sponsors.
Yeah, we can pass on that one.
Who knows? All right, you guys. We are halfway. Empty.
Halfway. That's halfway. What we usually say.
That's right. Yeah. Halfway through the show, we'll take a little break. Save the world, it could be up to you. Wait a second,
wait a minute, and we're through. Kinetic Legacy is the company that powers the Joe Contractor app. Their unique platform blends the good parts of social tech with their one-of-a-kind data organizing system, giving communities large and small a safe, private space to stay connected and to keep information and memories organized. If you and your community have a shared purpose or passion and are looking for a better way to stay connected, contact Kinetic Legacy today at kineticlegacy.us. Find out how groups from contractors to campers, tribal communities, unions, and alumni organizations are finding their way to meaningful new spaces in this increasingly digital world. Again, that's kineticlegacy.us.
If you're a fan of the show, you know that I love the outdoors. Several years ago, I stopped by a small, independent, and very much American-made little shop in Clarissa, Minnesota, called Battle Lake Outdoors. They sell the best quality canoeing packs, hunting packs, firefighting packs, and much more. Check them out at battlelakeoutdoors.com and use the coupon code LegacyMatters for a 5% discount on your order. Again, that's battlelakeoutdoors.com.
Wonder Woman Construction is a Minneapolis-based, woman-owned residential and commercial construction and electrical company. Lori and her team pride themselves on their commitment to long-term green and sustainable building practices, and they apply their deep understanding of building science to each project they take on. They are dedicated to the complete satisfaction of every client. One more thing that you absolutely cannot miss about Wonder Woman Construction is the fact that every employee loves what they do and truly enjoys working with each other. The best projects are those that are done by happy people. And Wonder Woman Construction is full of happy people. Visit WonderWomanConstruction.com to get started on your happiest project ever. Save the world, it could be up to you. Wait a second,
wait a minute, and we're through. I thought that was on.
No, we weren't recording.
We missed so much good stuff.
That was the funniest thing you've ever said.
Always. It's sad.
The best content is when you're not recording.
Our listeners are so tired of us hearing you say that. like you say that every time.
You suck. That's not true.
Yeah. They're like... Yeah, well, none of what you say is very funny, so I'm not buying
it. I understand how we missed the good stuff, because this ain't it.
Second half, we're going to say Mayor of Farmington, Joshua Hoyt, is with us.
Still.
We're going to say it because you sort of demystified this whole mayor thing. Because we had the city administrator for Newport, right?
I was not present. You weren't there. For,
was it Newport? Remember?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yep. Mark doesn't remember a thing.
No, that was exactly it. I remember.
It's Joe Hatch.
Joe Hatch.
But anyway.
From Newport.
Yeah. And city administrator. So, like, in a town that doesn't. You said something earlier. Like, you either have a mayor or a city administrator, right?
No.
Like, there's not always a mayor for every town, is there?
No, there's always a mayor, or in other states, there's a different terminology for it. Mm-hmm. But
what are the other terms? Would you prefer it's like magistrate? No, that's different.
No, but
that's
something like that. Yeah. Something. It's like a. It's not the constable because that's the sheriff, right?
Yeah, the sheriff.
But it's like that.
Would it be, right. Would it make really you feel cool to have whatever that one is?
Fuck no.
No, you like mayor? No. Oh, okay. Yeah. All right. Just checking.
So, to kind of simplify it for all of your listeners, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. They're into it.
Your city is an organization. It's a business, right? The head of that business is either the city manager, the city administrator, or in smaller cities, it may also be the city clerk. That is basically the CEO of the city.
Yeah.
Oh.
They are all employed by the organization that is the municipality, and your elected body is typically a council. That council can be 5, 7, 9, et cetera.
So Joe might have a more important job than you as city administrator.
He has the most important job at the organization.
Oh.
The policy decisions are ultimately made by the elected body, which is the council.
Gotcha.
Now, in a city like Minneapolis, they have something like 4,700 council members and one mayor.
We have 4,700 council members.
I think it's like 11 or 19 or something.
I was going to say. It's astronomical.
Sure. I was like, well, it does take up more than a lot of space on the ballot. Yeah.
Because he's full of it. Yeah. I think it's 11 is what it is.
It's like 11 or 13 or something.
Right. Yeah.
It's because each one represents a ward.
Yeah.
Right? So you live in this district or ward.
People love bagging on Minneapolis, but go ahead.
Y'all been through some shit. So
I mean, and to be fair, we do have our issues here in town.
Fair.
And
every city does.
Well,
some a little more than others, but you know.
Yeah. I will say, I think that one of the things that people, I know I got to let you talk, get back to your thing, but one of the people bag on Minneapolis about our city council, and I hear it, is we have a tendency to elect people who they are making policy, but they're not necessarily like the. People who have been in business or, you know, made those types of decisions. But it's important that we have diversity, but sometimes we've like diversified out the people who actually have managed companies and businesses and stuff like that. So we end up with these like sort of odd policies because that's not actually possible. What you're talking about here to get this done this way is not possible because you've never run a business. You don't get that. But anyway.
Correct.
Yeah.
Your council, like we have what's called a weak mayor council. That means that I am one of five.
Does that hurt?
No.
Okay.
Nope. Just it means that I don't have...
Wants to do better.
My vote is one, and it's equivalent with the four council members that I serve with.
Yeah. Okay.
So there's five members, five votes. They all have equal strength.
Okay.
I have three statutory authorities by the state. One is to declare a local state of emergency. Mm-hmm. Only I can do that. Mm-hmm. One is to ultimately be the presiding or the deciding vote in the matters of a tie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
so,
right.
Because so you can argue that my vote is worth more, but
slightly higher privilege.
When you vote last, you get to decide which side you're on.
In a tie. Yep. Got it.
And then the last is the authority to run, and you're responsible for the agendas and running the meetings.
Right.
So you are tasked with that. That is your responsibility.
Do you ever wish you could give that part up? Or do you have the
city clerk?
Give it up?
It's city clerk does the majority of it.
Yeah. That's
but I like I meet with my administrator once a week, and we talk about emerging issues and you know direction, and then we consult with the council in public forum and
so that administrator is more or less running the business of the
CEO.
City. Yep. Mm-hmm. And or directing the business of the city.
Think of it as the board of directors. The board of directors are not in the business, but they determine the direction.
Yep. And you
the
guys
CEO
are sitting there
runs the business.
More doing the board of directors stuff.
Correct.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Got
exactly.
it. I mean, that helps, actually. It makes a lot of sense.
Yep.
As much as I do enjoy politics and I've been involved enough in my life, I don't know a ton about how those things work. So if you're listening and you got some educational stuff from us, you can thank Joshua, because it wasn't us, right? We don't do that.
I never claim to be.
No, we're not. We're not generally educating people on very much of anything.
I jokingly say this about electeds. Do you know that there's very minimum qualifications for someone to be elected?
It explains a lot, and yes.
Yeah. 18 years of age. Yeah. You have to be a resident of your district for 30 days, and in most cases, you can't be a convicted felon.
Right. Most.
Yeah. Most, right?
Yeah.
Outside of that, and I say this often, we're not the smartest people in the room.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We're the elected policymakers.
You're the ones willing to do it.
They're the smart people. Yeah. They're the ones that should be guiding the direction. We ultimately have the authority to make the decision. But they're the smart people.
This goes right on up the chain, though, too. Like, I know that we care very much about who's president and everything, but and we throw a lot of weight at this one's the wrong one, and they're doing all the wrong things. Now, most of those decisions, most of the stuff that's happening out there in the world, in politics, in governance, I should say, not in politics, right. In the governance of things, it really isn't being directed by the head honcho. Like, they're
putting out some, hey, I'd like to see this, and everyone else goes,
well,
that's
send some ideas their way and stuff, but Yeah, we get so pissed off, always thinking that it's
easier to blame one person than everything that's wrong.
I suppose.
Here's what's fascinating.
Or
about,
fix what's wrong.
Yeah, exactly.
Maybe just do something better. Yeah, right. Anyway.
So I'll bring this back to the federal level for a second, but I want to start at the local level, right? We exist for core services.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Police, fire, water, sewer,
that's
streets,
why your local
maintenance.
Politics
that's
are
it.
So much yep. more important. Or local governments are
local
so
government.
Important.
Yep. It's not social issues. No. It's not social services. No. That's what the county is for. Right? That's where those...
Blame them.
The department sits there to take care of that.
Yep.
So when you get into some of these bigger cities where the social issues become emerging things, you go, that's not even your wheelhouse.
Right. It's not
get out of it. Yep. How are your streets? How are your sewer, water? Yeah. Right? So you go to the federal level, and I'll ask you each this question.
Ooh, I like it.
Why does the federal government exist?
Oh, shit.
To frustrate.
That's...
It's very simple.
Well, it protects us from foreign...
National security.
National security.
That's one.
infrastructure.
Yeah.
Protecting interstate commerce. Yeah, right? Like making sure states.
I like a freeway.
Yep.
And there's one more, and it's the most important one.
I'm just going to let you two go. I have no.
No,
I
mean, we've got ours.
Third one's all you, buddy. Bring us home.
Bring it back to the beginning.
Unify the different.
Preservation of the Constitution.
Yeah. Okay.
Outside of that,
you just cut him off. He was just about to say
just
that.
About to say
I
that.
I see him mouthing constipate.
No. I feel really out of it right now.
Okay.
No, you're right in the middle of it. Don't worry.
But legitimately, the federal government should only be there for preservation of the Constitution, to protect interstate commerce and rights within states working.
Yeah, that long ago fucking... Mm-hmm.
But why did
else.
It?
Yeah.
Because it always does.
No, we allowed it.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but...
we allowed it to change.
We elected officials that had a different agenda and wanted to do it differently.
Right.
The royal we. Okay.
Yeah. Not we as in... So, I mean, we allowed it, but we also demand it of them at times. Like
there are certain percentages of this population that want specific things and...
Yeah,
and elects their agenda.
I mean, I guess what I would say is if you were to look around the globe, would you find very many first world kind of, you know, wealthy countries where the government doesn't end up becoming something similar to what we've got, which is a whole bunch of different shit? Like, well, I think it's just the natural tendency of government to become that eventually.
So go to the form of government. Show me another democracy / republic that has been able to sustain time. We're 247 years.
Sustain over time, you
mean?
Over time. No, I mean, they all collapse eventually.
Because
under their own weight.
Under their own weight.
Yeah.
The ones that have managed to last far longer than the United States has been around have had what
and
form
who,
of...
And who would that be?
Well, go all the way... Go to China, Japan.
China.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah, but China is a... I mean...
communist dictatorship.
Yeah, it's a communist dictatorship. So, I mean, like
who started out with dynasties, which had one ruler.
Correct.
Yeah, but I mean, that's monarchical systems or whatever are different. So, correct. I mean, since the signing of the Magna Carta or whatever, like, is France an older democracy than ours? And has it
technically
yeah, yes. I mean, but that's what, 400-500 years old?
Yeah, I see. I mean, where you're going.
There aren't you know, I mean, the Romans fell to pieces. They had the Senate, they had a representative government. I mean, it's sort of the inevitable nature of representative government that you're going to end up becoming
mob
something
rules.
It's going to fall apart.
This is what's scary about our country and our time right now, and we're going through this at such a expedited rate, mm-hmm. is that under communist or dictatorship-type rule, you don't have that uprising of personal opinion. And so very much they can maintain order.
Tamp it
down. And we look at it from the outside and go, I would never want to live that way.
Yeah.
Well, ask them how they enjoy the way that they live. Mm-hmm. Like, it's sustainable, right?
Right.
Well,
bad, but it's sustainable.
But if we're, I mean, the reason I'll push back on this stuff is because ask whom? Like, are you saying, because I lived in Azerbaijan for a while, which is like Asian, you know, kind of. It's on that part. It's Middle Eastern, but sort of on the edge of the Asian continent there or whatever. I don't know. Anyway, ruled by the same family for the last 40 years or 30 years or whatever it is, right? And, you know, some people are happy and many aren't. Like, there's no, it's not.
Are enough people being taken care of in the current system
to not want to
tear it all down?
I don't know if everyone in China would say that they like their system or and I doubt everyone would say they dislike it. Like,
same here.
Same in Russia, you know, like, whatever. So,
right.
They're too afraid. To say what's really exactly. on their mind.
Right.
Well, in Russia, for sure.
And I don't say this from a pro stance, but you look at one of our greatest strengths actually has become one of our greatest weaknesses. And it is what is at the base of the political divide right now. It's our freedom of speech. It's our ability to say what we want, where we want, how we want.
Mm-hmm. But should be defended to the death. We should absolutely.
No matter what you're saying.
Hold on to that. Freedom of press should be defended as well.
Absolutely.
It's a really important one.
Yep. But we shouldn't be tearing ourselves down because we disagree over the right that we all have.
No.
Right.
And that's the most frustrating thing right now, is to see this political divide, this discourse, this, you know.
We should be realizing
it's not just frustrating. It's kind of getting scary because I feel that problem-solving activities that I would do in the course of my day for my own life or for my job or for, you know, whatever, like, those don't seem to matter anymore. Like, I just don't agree with you, and now I hate you, and now we're enemies, and
that's not going to work.
We're never going to find our common ground. That's terrifying to me. Because I don't feel that way at all. Like, you got to work it out.
2020 was pretty divisive.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Next June, when your primaries really kick off, buckle down. It is going to be a very...
Well, you heard it here first.
Yeah.
I tend to be an optimist. I look out at the world, and I think, you know, if what's required for us to set ourselves on a better course is for us to burn the shit down, because that's the only thing we can do to... Then we'll just do
it. Start over,
Then that's just what's going to happen. Because there's some... You know, like, forest fires are hyper-destructive, and they are...
Great for the environment after it's all over and done
with. You paddle through a wilderness that's been burned to the ground 10 years prior, and it's the greenest thing there ever was. So if we just can't... If we can't do it by nice means, then fuck it. I'm not going to be out there. I'm not going after any of my cousins or anyone who... we're all humans. I'm not going after anyone...
Yeah.
For any reason, but I'll, you know, obviously we'll see what happens. But my hope is that we find some other means by which we can come to agreement, not violence.
Right.
But who knows? It's pretty weird out there these days.
I really hope it doesn't get to the point where the average person
all the time.
has to bear an arm against government and or our own military. Yeah.
I hate to make jokes, but I just saw a bunch of people with like no sleeves, like bearing an arm.
Woo!
I'm doing it right now. No, I. That's so
and
dumb.
We lost.
Dad, we had a strong run there.
That's okay. We'll cut that out in post. Right.
No, we don't cut anything out. Yeah. That's the problem. Stays. It all stays.
I really don't want it to be super heavy. I completely understand what you're saying. I know that there's potentially trouble. I really hope
we've already seen it.
Skirt.
I mean, they've been here and there, and it doesn't seem to be going away.
I will say this. People have, so on the social side, it's way better to be gay in America right now than it was 20, 30, 40, 50, absolutely. 60, 70 years ago, whatever.
Until you need health care.
Well,
Sorry. Who's that?
No, I mean, it's the scales of equity or whatever have been tilting improved toward the better for a very long time. And if we got our heads out of our asses and stopped fighting with our neighbors, we might look around and say, okay, we've actually got kind of a good thing going here. Let's not screw this up.
People that don't want that to happen.
Oh my gosh, certain interests out there.
Like you're saying, looking out for your neighbor.
Yeah.
So you have strong opinions and hypothetically speaking, you have neighbors who maybe don't agree on things. Mm. But you want to hate them so much that you don't want to maybe vote in a way that would help them out?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean,
you can't
get
past
right
your own anger
it.
to mm-hmm. think your way through way to, again, problem solve?
Yeah.
Like Joshua adults was saying it, instead of fighting like savages.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. I mean, you were saying it a minute ago. You know, we got ourselves into we allowed this to happen.
Yeah.
Right.
Absolutely.
That same statement turns it back. The mirror comes back at us. We are the only ones who can get ourselves out of this. And that, mm-hmm. In the best vision I have of the future, we do that not by beating the crap out of each other or killing people. Like, it could get violent, I get that. But by actually just working it out somehow.
It's a worse truth conversation. Like, I enjoy interacting with someone who has the total opposite of my viewpoint.
Me too. Yeah.
Because I can learn, right? Yeah. I can listen and I can learn.
You can learn why they're wrong. And try and see them why you're right. You know,
and you can inform them if you're eloquent enough. You can inform them of how
you really
wrong.
Do learn. Because
and then follow them
for the
home
longest time. Things
them.
Were so divisive mm-hmm. that you literally could go, "How can you be that dumb? How can you not see it?" But it's like, wait, you have different information than I do. Okay, share with me what information do you have that makes you think this way and makes you think this way? Because I'm not seeing it.
Well,
I'm not listening to the same programs.
When that
I'm not watching it.
That person replies, "Don't worry, I got my news off of Facebook."
Exactly.
There's a problem.
Like, okay.
Yeah, you
and
just need to do your own research.
Point.
It's out there on
now
YouTube.
I can see why there are problems.
Okay.
No.
Yeah.
You almost want to like just wrap every. You know, let me back up. I get asked the question like, "What if you could tell? If you could send one message or say one thing that you knew everybody was going to hear?" Mm-hmm. I always answer the same way. I would want to put everyone in a room and say, "You may disagree completely with what I think, what I say, what I do. That's fine. But if we continue to disagree, the system wins." Mm-hmm. And then we both lose.
Yeah.
So the quicker we can figure out how to work in an area or live in an area where we can be polar opposites and we can have completely different views, but we both have to agree that that system thing, that big government mm-hmm. that's out there, is not good for us.
Yeah.
Like, the better we can be if we can get to that. Because right now, I mean, I'm telling you, some of this stuff that's coming down the pipeline is just, it's not pretty.
Yeah.
And it is very supportive of large government, and it is not good for the average folk.
No.
Yeah, I mean,
they're not creating new freedoms and things, making stuff easier for people. It's
No.
Yeah.
It's hard to just be a family.
We're not
take electric vehicles, for example.
Oh, okay.
Do we not all agree that, like, there's benefit to electric?
Yeah.
I love using my cordless tools.
Yep, there are benefits.
Right?
Sure.
There's huge benefits.
But they ain't clean.
They ain't clean.
Yeah.
Well, wait a minute now. What's not clean?
The entire process of the mining to source the batteries to get to production, the distribution of said vehicles across the system.
Yep, okay? What about it?
in order for us to get to a full electric or high percentage electric, as the administration has touted by certain, you know,
individuals,
certain individuals over certain decades, it is not possible.
Well,
it is not sustainable.
All right. Since we are this, we have a mayor on our show, right? And this is generally not a political show. And we had our last guest was someone who was harmed. Susanna Newell was harmed by taking the vaccine. We did a really nice job of going through that. So, listeners, if you want to step away for a few minutes, we'll go into the politics of this and we'll have a little debate back and forth,
sure,
because I don't mind doing it. And I think it's important that we have the conversations.
Yes.
But you're making some pretty broad statements there about, so let's start with a couple of different thoughts on are gasoline vehicles, in your opinion, a less environmentally detrimental way of humans transporting things around the planet? Like, is gasoline a better alternative to us turning to electric?
You have to look at the context of the statement.
But there's a question there.
Correct. But if I'm answering the question from a standpoint of the net impact of one vehicle and its output versus one...
But we'll go back to that.
Yep.
Okay, we'll get back to that, because I do have some thoughts or stats that I've read on it, too. But the reason I ask that question is I've always thought it was kind of funny that people drive gas-powered RVs and they're wearing clothing that's made out of oil-derived products, and they're protesting oil pipelines, right? And so oil pipelines, to me, are as far as I know, they're one of the safest ways for us to transport petroleum products, right?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
They're better than having trains barreling through your town, better than putting it all on trucks. It's a more efficient way of doing it. So
absolutely.
But the reality is, and I'm not a scientist, I could be wrong, but the reality is that we cannot sustain the oil production that we have, and we cannot continue to pull that much fossil fuel, that many fossil fuels out of the planet and burn it and live the way we're accustomed to, right? The planet doesn't actually give a shit about us. If we screw this up 10, 15 million years from now, it's going to be just fine.
Gotcha.
It does care. Yes.
Yep. So, she's good.
So I'm on the side of that, but I don't think that it's the way I see it. It should be possible for people to be pro oil right now and pro electrification in the future, because electric cars, to my understanding, they are about twice as detrimental to the environment at production.
Yep.
But over time, they are, within a year or two, they have far surpassed the gas vehicles in
impact
after that point. So they start out twice as impactful, but the gas vehicle continues to mount impact because it's burning gas and there's a lot more moving parts and there's things going on.
Yep.
The electric vehicle very quickly becomes a much more sustainable vehicle than the gas vehicle is. That's my understanding. Does that sound right?
Based on what I've heard and read myself,
yes. So at some point, we're going to have to, we all like traveling at 80 miles an hour.
Exactly.
We all like getting around. We all like going and visiting our relatives. At some point,
flying airplanes.
Right, exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
Which I sort of see it as one large, we sit in a basement in a bar in Minneapolis.
Yes, we do.
We fight over, we're going to say, this is good, this is bad, whatever. At the end of the day, we've got to transition to different ways of doing things that are more sustainable than the ones that we've got going now. That doesn't mean that, I just can't quite buy into the idea that it's some sort of big evil entity. It's market forces causing a lot of these things. We just don't like the idea of moving to electric vehicles. Plus, now we have to distribute electric power. You have to turn on a big faucet of electricity to get a car to charge up in 15, 20 minutes, right?
Yeah.
And we have to, when
I guarantee you, before we had gas stations distributed all across the country, it was hard to get a car across the country.
Yeah.
But we came up with a way to put gas stations on every frickin' corner, right?
Correct.
Yeah.
We need to put, if we're going to go electric, if that's where we're headed, yep. and there's going to be friction with it, but then we have to put electric gas stations on every corner so people can do it that way. And if there's something else out there that's even better for the whole world, then that would be great too, right?
Mr. Fusion from Back to the Future.
Yeah.
No. Sorry.
Right? Yes.
That. You know, yeah. like right? you just put you know a couple banana peels and you know some.
That's what I want.
Some compost. Mm-hmm. You just throw it in yes. there, and it's just va 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 boom.
Yes. But in the meantime, everybody's got an opinion on all of it, and everyone's all fighting about it all. But
I just don't like being talked down to by people who drive a Tesla,
right.
who think that they are just. Not doing it like they're just like yeah.
that's
so
separate.
Much better right. because they're so clean. And I'm saying anytime you manufacture anything, it's dirty.
Right.
I don't care what it is. Manufacturing well, part of can it is be being a dirty mandated, process. Like,
okay, we have to have this
and the being
vehicles
talked down
changed.
To.
Yeah.
Yeah. yeah.
Right. Like that.
Like
my younger brother. I won't call him out.
I've got
a whole bunch of younger brothers, so we'll just say it's one of them.
You're so safe right there.
Yeah.
You suck.
The divine fleet.
Yeah. Yes.
yeah, yeah. Well, I'm the only divine. I took my wife's last name.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. yeah. She's the death of her lineage. So I said, you know what? There's a lot of Teasons out
there.
There's
a lot of them floating around out there.
Yeah. yeah. I got a lot of siblings. Let's just go ahead and I'll take your name and pass it on to our kids. But anyway, no, my brother and I have, you know, he's ex-military. Oh, now he knows who I'm talking about.
Yeah,
but anyway,
it was only
a matter of time. He and I have very differing political and ideological viewpoints a lot of times. We actually very much care for each other. So we've had points throughout our lives where we couldn't talk to each other.
you know?
Like, it wasn't going so good. But for the most part, we have long, decent conversations about things that are pretty difficult because we come at them from such different views.
You have to be able to.
Yes, you do. And one of them was, you know, that we had was COVID. And after several hours of talking, we kind of, you know, we came to understand the other person's viewpoint better. And I don't think anyone was out to harm people by creating this vaccine. I think there were people, it's not a political thing. The minute it got politicized, it fucked everything up.
Which is usually the case.
It's always the case. But anyway, you know, after several hours, one of his main points was, I just don't like people telling me what to do.
Yeah.
Ooh.
You know, like it kind of
mandates.
Boiled down to that of after you get through everything else.
Theory of constraints. Right?
Yeah.
Exactly.
You know, and
you
I
want
teased
the illusion
him,
that you have a choice.
I teased him a little bit about like, okay, but you realize that that this was done. The science has been pretty clear on it. You know, you're a lot less likely to get hospitalized. And I don't want to go down that rabbit hole, but the science is pretty clear that this was done not to harm people, but to help them. And it has had an effect, the vaccine. But anyway, his sort of, but I don't like people telling me what to do. I thought we should put a box out with vaccine in it and say, you can't have this. This isn't for you. And then he would probably take it. You know, because it's really in his mind sort of like
defiance disorder.
Yeah, like, you, yes, oppositional defiance disorder. But it's don't fucking tell me what to do. So whatever. But like that's hard to it's hard to have arguments with when the differences between the way people think could come down to something that simple, too. So, yeah,
absolutely.
Whew, man. All right, we're back.
Are we? Rant over.
Yeah. Oh, boy.
So what do you do for fun, Joshua? Yeah. This is where, you know, we usually talk about lighter.
And I wanted to know if you did you grow up in the area? Have you always been in the Farmington area? Where'd you grow up?
So I was born in Southern California, Poway.
So no.
Due east of Del Mar, northeast of San Diego. My dad was in the Navy. I was a California native for 9 days.
Okay.
Yeah. And then moved back to where my mom and dad were both from, which is Mankato.
Okay. I lived there. Are Minnesotan.
Yeah.
Despite your Californian roots.
Yes. The majority of my time has been spent in the MN.
Yeah.
Lived in Mankato until 89, which would have been about age 10, fifth grade.
Okay.
And then we moved up to the metro. Technically lived in Lakeville, but we were in the Farmington School District, and that's where we spent all of our time. Yeah. I graduated, and then I was in the Marine Corps. So I went to California for boot camp and primary, went to Florida for my primary school, and then I was stationed in Beaufort, South Carolina, so right between Savannah and Charleston. Did 3.5 years, came back, lived in Farmington for, I think, 3 years. Then I moved to Rosemount, then to Northfield, and then back to Farmington in 15. So
okay. You're an advocate for were you injured in combat?
I got out June of 01. Okay. I got out right before shit hit the fan.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
But you are an advocate for all things military, correct?
100%.
Yeah.
Actually wrote a paper my first semester in college, English Comp 1108. It was a persuasive speech, and I wrote it on mandatory service requirements.
Ah.
Nice.
And, you know, the situations under which you wouldn't be part of that, but the benefits behind it and all the things.
It's fucking socialist.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I winked at you. Yeah. No,
you couldn't hear that.
Yeah. Right? But I love it because I lived in Germany for a while and I thought that was a really nice part of their system.
I think it's kind
of
cool too.
Yeah. Like,
it really changes the system, who it affects. And
I mean, you have to get in. You know, like have to see how the sausage is made a little bit,
it's
right? True.
But it's a nice dose of learning at the right age and good experience. I don't know.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of the CCC too. I wish they would bring something similar to that back and just. I mean, there's so much that you can learn at 18, 19, 20 years old about hard work and you know how things get finished and done and working in teams and. Yeah.
Even beyond the skills, you know, the skills, knowledge and stuff, right? But just the being in the service of something that is greater than
it's
you.
It's the socialization part of it that's important.
Yeah. Yes.
Giving
back to your community, your country, what have you.
Again, my little brother talks about, you know, when he was in the military, they'd have a pile of rocks in one spot and they'd say, move that pile of rocks over there. And then, you know, 2 hours later when they're done, they'd be like, move that pile of rocks back over there or whatever. It's the work. It can be important, but it doesn't have to be important. It's just the learning of
the lesson,
lesson that you get from it. Yes.
Yep.
So
absolutely.
The knowledge.
Yep. Mm-hmm. I'd be all for that. So, do you have do you find yourself like surfing in your dreams or anything? Because you're like, I am partially Californian, dude.
No,
bro.
No,
not that kind of California.
I've gone back and visited California, and I don't know. It's not for me.
It feels foreign now because you know Minnesota.
Because those 9 days weren't enough to cement.
Right. I've got family in Southern California, and I've been out. I've spent some time out there, and I just don't know. I mean, it's nice. It's a repeatable day, right?
It's a great place to visit.
And sunny, but
really pretty. Yeah, that part of it.
Yeah.
But except then you miss the fact that is it really going to be 75 again tomorrow?
It's the same thing. Same thing every single day.
Groundhog
Day.
Yeah. I was born in Portland, Oregon. I think I spent 6 months of my life there, whatever. I'm Minnesotan as well, but there's something about Portland that draws me. When I'm there, there's a little piece of me that feels like it's home in a certain way.
Yeah.
So I was just curious if 9 days was enough or if it took longer.
Just long enough to want to go back and visit.
Sure.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. I don't want to move out to Portland. That's not my goal. But every time I'm there, I'm like, something. Like, it's just, in my blood, I guess.
Just one single tear.
Right.
Yeah.
And then it gets sucked back in
your
eye.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Yep.
I love Minnesota. If you're not from Minnesota and you're listening to this podcast, you should not move here. It's terrible. The winters are awful.
We tell people that because we don't want more people coming in. We're fine the way we are.
You can move to Farmington. They need the tax revenue.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
If you like green, Yeah. You'll get it for a couple months out of the year, a lot of it, and then not.
Yeah, extraordinarily hot and then really cold. So what do you do for fun? Like, what are, do you have any sort of hobbies?
My hobbies are, I mean, more than anything, it's fishing. I love fishing. Absolutely love fishing.
Oh, God, well, you didn't even say that.
Yeah, I love fishing, love being on the water.
We're done.
What kind of fishing?
Largemouth bass predominantly.
Okay.
Yeah. Chasing toads.
Yeah, sure. Oh,
you fish, Sam?
I've been known to, on occasion.
Does your pole have a bobber on it?
Which pole?
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I mean,
see,
I've got no less than.
So now we're into the second half of the show.
Yeah, right.
The third half. Yeah. Okay. No, I mean, I've got enough.
People Snoopy fish in Minnesota. To go around.
Enough fishing rods to outfit any number of people. So I guide canoe trips occasionally, right?
Oh, sure.
And I worked at a boys' camp and I fished every day, right? Yeah. But if I've got 10 people want to go fishing with me, I'm like, I got you. You know, I'm not like I don't collect rods, but I definitely.
But you could be accused of collecting rods.
Yeah.
So with that one, the little plastic one.
Right.
Yeah. So where do you fish?
It's always Lake X.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you don't want to tell anybody.
You're right.
I'm not looking for an actual lake, but like locally, or do you head out? Like, are you kind of a
little bit of both? I mean, predominantly I fish in season locally, so it's you know, upper reservoirs or lakes. I tend to stay out of the river. It's a little bit of madness there.
Yeah.
The river, meaning
literally fishing in the river.
No, I know, but like the Mississippi?
Yeah. Yeah, Mississippi or St. Croix, I just don't have any desire to fish it.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy out there. I mean, they're not the best largemouth fisheries.
The backwaters and stuff you can get into, but it's just, you know, the ramps typically aren't the best. You have to travel more. You're dealing with...
I think we lost these two. They're like,
no, you didn't see it.
Mark's out.
I eat fish. I love seafood restaurants. Right.
And then it became a fishing podcast.
Exactly.
Oh,
we went from politics to fishing.
Wow.
And that's, you know, and that's not a bad transition.
We lost everybody.
No, the segues are unbelievable. Yeah, here.
Thanks, Josh. Well, you ruined it for us.
No, I don't think it was him.
Oh, shit. It was me. Sorry, folks.
No, that's right. No, he said the magic word. I like to fish. Oh, hell.
I know.
Which is very common. I don't dislike fishing.
You know, like, I've got three children. My two boys are like, whatever.
We went fishing.
Give or take.
It was great. I love deep sea fishing. That was fun.
It was cool being out there. I would like to be out in our own.
I don't see that going well.
Chasing you and fish. I'd love it.
I don't know.
I'd love it.
Before we leave, I got to show you a picture
someone
of my
would have to drive.
Deep sea trophy that I caught.
Oh, very nice.
60-inch wahoo.
Oh,
there you go.
Yeah, legit trophy
wahoo,
fish.
Right?
Yeah.
I think so. Yeah. All right. Well, I'll tell you what.
Yeah.
We should wrap this up. I think we're another 40 minutes into it.
Yeah. No, that's good.
Is there anything that we didn't touch on that you really wanted to sort of...
To get out there.
To get out. Yeah, I mean...
Walk, support people.
Support cancer research and whatnot, right? Your walk, support. That's good.
We talked a lot about that. Your local government.
We can close it with the feels a little bit, you know?
Yeah, let's do some feels. Yeah. I didn't even cry this show.
I mean...
I cried a lot the last one, I think.
Really? So,
I mean, at the end of the day, like, legitimately, like, we just need to be better human beings.
Yeah.
I am with you 100%.
It is... It is remarkably simple, and we managed to screw it up. Mm-hmm. And if you just show grace, patience, compassion, just be a good human being, you know, recognize that others have different views. You can agree to disagree. It's okay to even get a little heated over it from time to time.
But as long as you're decent.
Recognize we can be
considerate about it.
You can.
Just be good human beings. Do for others first, and your life will be very fruitful.
Yeah, I think the patience and listening thing is the part that we seem to be lacking so heavily these days.
Yeah.
So,
compassion.
Yeah, a little bit of empathy, folks. A little bit of having Susanna Newell in that. All she really wanted this, you know, she and others. I'll just say when you inject people with something, someone's going to get hurt.
Yeah.
There's statistically, it's impossible for it not to happen.
Right.
Right.
Yep. And it happened.
And when people don't want that to be part of the narrative and they don't listen to those folks, that's just shitty.
Yeah,
like just all qualify she really it wanted and... was people to listen.
Yeah, people to hear and go, oh yeah, just, that's something that happened.
Yeah, so that's compassion. That's that's patience, and that's hearing people. And I'm right there with you, Joshua. And thanks a lot for coming in.
Yeah.
Thanks for the invite. Appreciate it.
I don't know. I think the city of Farmington might be lucky to have you.
Yeah. Better
off. I agree. That's,
Yeah, we agree on that?
I think we can all agree
on
that.
We say nice shit on the show. We'll bag on them next time.
Nah.
No.
I'll get my sponsorship request form on the way out the door.
Exactly.
I won't.
No, we don't do that. We know that's not happening. We're good.
Oh. In one of these days.
Could happen.
All right, you guys. I appreciate it. Thanks for coming.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, you did it. You made it to the end of another show. Thank you all so much for listening to our show. We really, really appreciate it. Don't forget to send us your questions, comments, or even your guest requests. Maybe you want to be a guest. Maybe you know someone who would be a great guest. Send them in to info@legacymatterspodcast.com. All right. See you next time. Theme music and all the other music that you've heard on this show is created by and recorded by the fabulous Captain Al. Check him out.